Before we start, I want to make it clear that this movie is a victim of CIS, which stands for Comedy is Subjective, meaning that while I think it's one of the greatest movies ever made, it might not be for everyone. Thank you for your understanding, and there will be spoilers for Hellphone in this video, of course. Teen horror movies have never been regarded as cinematic masterpieces, which makes sense to some extent, as the target demographic isn't usually the pickiest when it comes to consuming media. Today, though, I want to focus on the comedy side of teen horror movies, as while this niche is becoming more saturated with every passing Halloween, it does have some gems. Movies like The Faculty, The Cabin in the Woods, Scary Movie 4, and with the exception of the last one, these movies do such a good job of balancing between the terrifying, tension-filled aspects of horror movies with some of the goofiest jokes that manage to break the tension. I understand that cracking one-liners every few seconds can be destructive to the immersion of a movie, as too much meta will make the viewer suffer. But in the case of movies like The Faculty, the jokes are placed in moments that don't feel intrusive. This is all thanks to the work from brilliant writers like Kevin Williamson. So far, I've only mentioned American movies, which makes sense as most of the media consumed around the world is produced in that bizarre burger country, but there are some hidden gems found in other places. Today, I want to introduce you to one of the best movies in this teen horror comedy genre from my home country, the great nation of France. This movie being Hellphone, a 2007 movie directed by James Huth. If James Huth is a name familiar to any of you, it's probably because Hellphone wasn't his first movie. James Huth is a director slash writer born in Belmont in the UK, known for creating movies like Serial Lover or the 2009 adaptation of Lucky Luke, but you probably know him best for contributing to the creation of the French icon Brice de Nice. He hasn't had the most extravagant career, but considering he's appealing to a much smaller market, I'd say he's doing a pretty good job for himself. For a bit of context, I barely consume any French media, as there's not much that really piques my interest, so most of the French media I consume are either daytime TV shows or movies my family want to watch, because what better way to get closer to your parents and siblings than watching possibly traumatizing movies about demonic mobile phones? One important detail I want you to remember is that this movie is set in 2007, a time before mobile phones were available for everyone to buy. At this point, there were still a lot of skeptics, and just obtaining a decent Nokia phone probably will cost you your liver. It's the same type of feeling people had towards video games in the 90s, where parents feared it would corrupt their children and banish them to hell. This message about phone equals bad is almost always present in the movie, so while it may seem stupid today, keep in mind 2007 was a very different time. And I think that pretty much wraps up our introduction, so without further ado, let's get into the movie review! This movie introduces us to our protagonist, Sid, a high schooler who's visibly in love with this other student at his school, but is clearly reluctant to put himself out there. I can tell he's a high schooler because as soon as he tries out anything new, it fails miserably, making him 4 times more insecure than he ever was before, creating this endless cycle of self-loathing. We also quickly learn of the existence of his best friend Pierre, or as he's known in the streets, Tiger, who gets his nickname from the fact that he's a ginger child, which probably makes him look like an animal. In this first scene, Sid embarrasses himself in front of the girl of his dreams, Angie, and through subtle visual clues, we can immediately gather a lot of info on these two characters. Sid dresses in an AC/DC shirt, a band loved by people for being loud, rambunctious, and even sometimes childish. Angie, on the other hand, wears a David Bowie shirt. This immediately puts her in a position of almost godlike status, or emphasizes that she's out of this world, as David Bowie has that certain mystique to him. So the contrast between the two showing that they're on different worlds is already very clear, as one of them is down in hell, while the other is looking down on him from the sky. After a very awkward interaction, Sid, being the Sigma male that he is, asks to be Angie's white knight, effectively helping her move to Paris be a little smoother, as yes, she's a new student to the school, making her even more special than just with that David Bowie reference. The school bullies, notice this, and because apparently the leader of the group, Virgil, is already dating this girl, they have to put a target on Sid's back. While I normally hate this bully trope in movies, I have to say that this trio is just so cartoonishly evil that you can't even be afraid of them anymore. The bizarre cuts between Virgil and Sid make the scene even better. Eventually, Angie asks for Sid's number, but Sid doesn't have a phone, which prompts Tiger, the best character in this goddamn movie, to lie out of his ass, making Sid look less poor and more like a player who gets his phone stolen by all the bad bitches he regularly pulls.
Il a dû résilier sa ligne à cause d'une de ses ex qui le harcelait, une top de 19 ans, russe, grosse prise de tête, tu vois ce que je veux dire.
Angie then goes somewhere with the bullies, which leads us to our next scene, where Sid goes home and finds a dead child in his house. This scene is meant to build tension with the audio changing to dramatic strings and disorienting camera movements, but all that tension is taken away when Sid just walks over the dead child to get some VB long neck from the fridge. The kid then looks up at Sid, creating some doubt in the viewer's mind about what exactly is going on in this household. Sid's mom then comes back and threatens to kill the dead child, turning off the radio, taking away the strings that were previously playing, which already shows that this isn't the first time the kid has done this.
Tu bouges plus! Non, je te jure, je te tue pour de bon, moi!
Qu'est-ce qu'il fait ici? On n'est pas mercredi.
C'était pour une heure, je pouvais pas refuser.
We then learn that this kid isn't even related to Sid, as he's just a neighbor's kid, making the stereotype of neighbor's kids being so damn bizarre even more true. Now, this scene is very important for two reasons. One, it lays down the fact that this movie will try to do everything to subvert your expectations, as the entire scene was supposed to build up to an important crime scene, even if it ended up being a prank. And two, it leads up to some decent world building, as the fact that Sid's mother is caring for another child in their building during the day either means that she's jobless, she has night shifts. This scene is also important as it highlights just how much Sid and his mother care for each other. Sid wants to help out his mom as much as he can by cleaning up the mess the neighbor's kid made, and Sid's mom just wants to see him happy by giving him his birthday allowance a few days early, and regretting not being able to give more, showing us that this family isn't the most fortunate in Paris, which also makes Sid the underdog of the story, making us more sympathetic towards him by proxy. The next scene then shows Sid at his job working the deep fryer at a fried chicken joint, where he seems to be mistreated by his awful boss, Fritz the Chicken Man, once again showing us that he doesn't come from the richest family, as he's forced to work these awful low-paid jobs where he gets abused by his boss even when he asks for the smallest of favors. After getting epically pranked by the Chicken Man, he goes into the small shop to buy a secondhand phone in a scene very reminiscent of Gremlins. He buys a cool little Chinese phone for 30 euros, but the catch is that it doesn't work. He only learns of this after buying the phone though, which just makes the cartoonishly scummy shopkeeper even more scummy. The phone then magically turns on and Sid makes a run for it after making some racist comments about a certain Chinese chairman and hearing the gong getting smashed in the background. 2007 was a different time. He then learns that his phone number is 0666 0666 06, which would make JStation proud at the number of subtlety within those digits. His phone didn't even need a SIM card for a number though, so Sid is fine with it. He tries to get Angie's phone number, but because his phone is not the newest iPhone 46, the girls that hang out with Angie decide to mock him, making the phone do something, I don't know. Tiger, God bless his soul, cheers up Sid by reminding him that maybe Angie isn't hot shit, as she isn't intellectually capable as the boys are. Cut to chemistry class, where we learn that Tiger has also got to go through some hardships in life, as his mother is a porn star, something that the guys in this class remind him of every day.
Merci tous mes potes sati qu'elles mangent sur ma mère.
Ouais, moi je l'ai fait.
While all this is going on, we get some more phone talk from the bullies, comparing their phones and showing off how cool they are, obviously hinting at the fact that at some point, at least one of them will make fun of the cute red phone. And also solidifying the fact that the message of this movie is just, phone is addicting, phone is bad, don't use phone will kill you. Sid then tries to defend his friend's honor, but gets 4 hours of detention. Can you tell just how this movie feels about high school yet? Me neither. Once again, the movie highlights just how unrealistic these bullies are by making one of them do that corpse husband snarl towards the goth girl in Angie's friend group. And between all the attacks on Sid and the rants from the girl with the same hair as Princess Leia from Star Wars, the magic phone then dials a phone number, this number being the one belonging to Margot's phone. She answers and gets a call from this ominous voice who says a couplet about how much Clemens is a bitch and deserves to burn in hell. Like any normal person, Margot proceeds to set Clemens's hair on fire with a Bunsen burner, which sucks for her as her hair was probably one of the most prized possessions. Hard cut to the principal's office, where we find out about another unrealistic character, Principal Tamale, who has this weird obsession with his goldfish. I think at this point it's important to point out just how outlandish some of the parts in this movie are. I am aware that the premise is completely unrealistic, but this movie can have some really poignant moments and characters like Sid and his mother, for example. The scenes they share together have that realism factor that almost none of the movie has, which immediately puts important onto them. The main characters Sid, Tiger, and Angie are somewhat grounded, which makes them automatically stand out, as everyone else is just so extreme, which I think is a fantastic stylistic choice, as while it's obvious to see who the movie wants you to care about, you also feel less distracted by some of the more one-off irrelevant characters. Speaking of unrealistic, the principal's office is just as nauseating as it just keeps extending forwards like a never-ending corridor from a nightmare, which could be interpreted as a perception of a scared child going to that principal's office after being sent there for doing something stupid, just giving a bit of that childhood nostalgia that every movie's tried to use for some reason. They then go to French Hot Topic, which is now under new ownership. Once again, we get this cartoonishly scummy shopkeeper who basically tells the kids to fuck off, as he hates gingers like Tiger.
C'est marrant pour un mec qui vend des sketchs, j'aime pas les roux. T'as capté?
Hey, tu dégages.
This scene itself isn't what's important, but what comes after it is a detail I love, because they talk about beating the shopkeeper up to death without acting on it, and in front of a red background, hinting at the fact that the hell phone is listening on this conversation and is getting ready to make the shopkeeper suffer as soon as Sid gives the signal. We still don't know what the phone wants from Sid at this point, but the fact that the scenes where Sid is openly aggressive towards someone else are primarily occupied by the color red is great at signaling the potential threat looming over the horizon. Sid is then seen practicing his riz in front of his phone, and for some reason he openly admits that Angie makes him hard. Turns out that his phone was actually calling her the entire time, unbeknownst to him, which makes him panic and lie. He tells Angie that he's actually taking Swedish experimental theater classes in the most awkward way possible, and after maybe salvaging a lost cause, he hangs up. For the first time, we get to see the interface of the phone, where there's a pentagram pattern with devil horns and skulls everywhere, and once again not so subtly hinting at the fact that maybe this phone has affiliations with the devil. He also finds out that his phone was also the one who called Margot, which confuses him even more. Maybe, just maybe, this phone is possessed by the devil. But hey, that's just a guess. In math class, he finds himself in purgatory as he tries to balance between figuring out why his phone called Margot's, resisting the urge to run away from Angie after yesterday's awful call, and dodging chalks thrown by his math teacher because at this school, the teachers can physically attack the students. It gets so bad at one point that the math teacher throws the hell phone out of the classroom window and gives attention to Sid and Tiger for even attempting to object to his decision. In case you didn't know, this is a normal school in France. The phone is probably a Nokia though, as it doesn't even have a scratch when Sid finds it. We then get more scenes from the brainlit bullies and see that Virgil is making moves on Angie, both literally and figuratively. Later that night, the math professor receives a mysterious phone call and tries to do a Kubrick stare or something, I don't really know. It's now Sid's birthday, and the first person to remind him of that is his phone, which displays a holographic display, which then disappears when he blows it away. I can guarantee you that this is the movie that inspired Elon Musk to make Tesla. We then meet Tiger's mother and get a quick glimpse into his lifestyle. Tiger seems to be a lot more spiritual than the other characters in this movie. This is made clear from the sitar playing in the background and the elephant motifs scattered around the scene. She also prays for Sid and his mother, telling us that his father isn't with them anymore. From this front door, we can gather that Tiger is also somewhat affluent, as his house has multiple stories, and they seem to live in a house instead of a usual apartment. Keep in mind that this is the city of Paris, an extremely expensive city when it comes to housing, so the fact that they own a house says a lot. The two then argue for a bit about what to do with the creepy phone. Sid wants to keep it, and Tiger wants to throw it away, as it seems too powerful and suspects there may be a catch to all of this sudden power. They decide to try out how powerful it is by asking to get rid of the 6 hours of detention. The phone then calls the receptionist of the principal's office, so Sid tries to cancel the call, but when he gets on the phone, he ends up sounding like Tamale on the other end of the line. With this newfound power, he cancels detention and puts McDonald's on the school canteen menu, because what better way to make your life better than when constant fast foods? All their concerns about the phone after this are just gone away, which completely invalidates their previous argument, and they compare it to Aladdin's lamp, an object that everyone knows to be powerful. You get to wish 3 times for anything, and after that, you move on to another user. This comparison could be interpreted as the phone being a good thing as it will benefit them in day-to-day life, but on the other hand, this comparison could be a sign of time ticking down until a calamity happens. Who knows what might happen when this phone uses up all its wishes? There are no explicit laws that say just how much it can be used, but I think this is better as it creates more tension due to the fact that we never know when this phone might just snap. The two then go to a travel agency where they book tickets to another country just in case they run out of quote-unquote witches, which is a cute way of showing just how awful France is and that you should never go there hoping to enjoy yourself. In the next scene, we see the math teacher with so many chalks up his mouth that it takes him around 10 seconds to fully get rid of them all, finally revealing what the phone had done to him. The main duo then use their newfound power to harass the Hot Topic owner, making him participate in animal roleplay. I will let you make of that what you will.
He doesn't flinch at torture, human trafficking, or genocide.
They proceed to get a lot of the items from the shop for free! They then celebrate by going to a strip club, which I won't show here due to some reasons. They force Tamale to eat his goldfish in a scene with so many shaking camera angles that it's like an episode of Breaking Bad. Tiger then asks to use the phone for a bit as he wants to fix his parents' marriage, but Sid initially refuses, which could follow your, you know, normal movie tropes, as he's becoming Gollum little by little. This movie then subverts your expectations though, as Sid hands over the phone after giving a weird Gollum speech. The phone then makes things personal with Tiger as it activates the anti-redhead lock, effectively turning it off while it's being used by him. He throws it in a soda cup in a fit of rage and leaves, which makes Sid panic as he quickly picks it up again to start reminding himself that it is his phone and that the phone chose him over anyone. This cements the whole phone equals bad and children will get addicted to the mentality that the movie has. Later that night, Sid's mom tries to take his phone to look at it for a few seconds, but he snatches it back without saying anything, really highlighting his obsession with it. This also flabbergasts his mom as he's becoming more distant and colder towards her, showing us that this phone might not actually be great for his relationships. Sometime after, we get some more cartoonishly evil shenanigans from the bullies. However, after Angie's bag gets stolen, we get this cool scene where it's a race across Paris to catch some thieves. The bullies take Virgil's car while Angie and Sid skate through the entire goddamn city of Paris, which just shows Sid that she is the girl of his dreams. One of the bullies gets a call from presumably the hell phone, which forces the car to crash into some construction site, putting them out of the race to catch these thieves. The skaters then catch up to the thieves and Angie goes ballistic, which brings the police to them in a very bizarre scene as the police are just kind of there. The two then walk for a bit and Angie asks an important question after Sid reveals that he can get her to the history exam paper before it happens. She asks him why men always feel the need to puff their chests out all the time. They're all the same as they think impressing a girl is all it takes to attract them. This makes Sid think for a bit as he realizes that maybe the power he got from the hell phone isn't necessarily what's gonna get him to Angie. Maybe he actually needs to put in some effort too. This starts off a small character arc where Sid might actually learn to disconnect from the phone a little more. It doesn't start immediately though, as Sid gets the history paper and forces the teacher to embarrass himself in front of the class by showing up in his best Tyler Ninja Blevins Fortnite cosplay. We then cut to an extremely weird scene in the church in the school for some reason where we see the aftermath of the car crash. Virgil's left arm is broken and one of his henchmen's minds has completely snapped. He is now the reincarnated Green Goblin and his purpose in life is to make Tiger suffer. The hell phone tries to call Virgil, but Sid saves him as he's just too honorable to let this sadistic piece of shit die. It's revealed that he also has the history papers, and after learning of Sid's usefulness, he spares the two skaters. Also, the math teacher is probably dead now, so that's a fun throwaway gag. It's now lunchtime and everyone gets McDonald's. Virgil then becomes even more insane as he explains that gratitude is for poor people, which prompts Angie to invite Sid to their lunch table. Tiger walks away though as he's tired of the simping, which forces Sid to choose between the bro or the hoe. Obviously he sits down with Angie because what kind of male high schooler wouldn't? The math teacher isn't dead either, so this movie becomes a 10 out of 10 as the second best character is revealed to be alive. Sid gets bullied at the table for being fatherless though and tells the phone to call Virgil. Virgil then starts stripping atop a canteen table, which just makes this movie even more absurd than it already was. Crazy how much of a roller coaster it can be. After publicly calling his girlfriend a slut and making out with his best friend, Angie walks away in disgust and the whole dance abruptly ends. Sid takes his opportunity to riz up Angie with a Forrest Gump reference, and it somehow works as he has a cinema date with her on the following Saturday. On the actual day of the date, Tiger comes in while Sid is changing into a suit and reminds Sid that they have an AC/DC concert to watch together, which once again forces Sid into the ultimatum of bros or hoes. Sid automatically chooses to leave Tiger to go on a date, and Tiger blames it on his phone as it has turned him into a simp. It has corrupted his heart, and all he sees now is titties. Sid responds with possibly the worst answer ever and just tells him he grew up. Tiger is visibly breaking down and yelling at Sid while he responds with some Patrick Bateman smile while flashing his phone and putting Tiger back in his place. He reminds Tiger, or Pierre, that they're completely different and could never consider him a brother as he was much richer than Sid. Sure, they were both fatherless, loved AC/DC and skating, but they were always from different worlds. For the first time, Sid admits this to Pierre and tells him to go home, as for the first time he's finally had something good happen to him.
On n'est pas des frères, Pierre. Toi, tes parents sont blindés.
Second act falling outs are so common and I genuinely am tired of them. They're so played out and I can't deny the fact that this one doesn't really put a spin on the formula. Although I will let it slide as for the most part this movie has barely had any remotely realistic conflict, so for this one to be the first and for it to be so organic, I'll let it slide. While Sid speedran becoming the biggest asshole in the world a few seconds ago, he still immediately regrets pushing Tiger away, which shows that he's still somewhat human. which adds even more realism to this completely unrealistic world. As Sid's about to leave, he notices his mom crying. He comes back to ask what's wrong, showing that he still has a heart under all of that American psycho impersonation, and it turns out that she's actually having tears of joy as she's going to Cuba under the premise that she won the lottery. Turns out this is what Sid got her when he went to the traveling agency earlier, proving to the audience that maybe Sid isn't so bad after all. He then yells at the neighbor's kids for spearing Nutella on his suit, so who knows if Sid is actually Patrick Bateman or not. Sid also wishes death on the Chicken Man from his job, and the phone kills him by making the Chicken Man put his head in the deep fryer, as clearly, he doesn't own an air fryer. I could make a character analysis on the Chicken Man, as he's such a strong allegory for the people at the top of society, but it's probably funnier to just leave his character as a deep fried Chicken Man. We then get to see what Angie's house is like, and feels like a museum, as various sculptures are scattered around the large estate. Angie's mom also makes an appearance, and she appears to be as quirky as everyone else in this film. Also, it turns out that Angie is the daughter of Mike Bullitt, a very famous, I assume, American skater who holds a world record for something, I don't know, which makes Angie seem even more out of this world and like the perfect girl for him. Meanwhile, the bullies are chilling and realize that the phone calls are the catalyst for these horrible events. They're passed by Sid and Angie, who are in a stolen car which apparently belongs to Virgil's dad, which leads them to try to follow the couple as they go on their first date. Sid wants to talk about his phone to Angie in the cinema, but realizes that he's forgotten the stolen car, so he goes to retrieve it, but runs into Virgil and the gang, who beat the shit out of him as Sid is driving the car that Virgil's dad loves more than he loves his son, which raises a few questions, but I'm not gonna go into that today, as it's probably funnier to just imagine Virgil as someone who is insane, simply for the reason that he was born insane. The couple then have a small falling out though, as Sid reveals that he stole a car to try to impress her, as he's just so insecure about being poor around her. She then tells them to not judge a book by its cover, they apologize to each other, and everything immediately goes well again, which kind of sucks as I wish to, you know, have a bigger conflict between the two, or at least just see Sid's life fall apart more, making his character arc even more deserved. But hey, I guess they talk through their conflict and everything works out in the end, so good for them. They get horny while watching the movie Dead End, another film by James Huth, and the movie transitions really well into the next scene featuring Virgil and the gang, who are now speeding on the freeway and being generally insane. One of the guys picks up the cell phone and answers a call on it, which makes him jump out of the movie car, probably killing him considering they were driving at more than 100 kilometers per hour. He doesn't die though, and is completely unscathed, so he smokes a ciggy to relieve himself, only to get hit by a truck that advertises the fact that smoking kills. Ironic, I know. Angie gets increasingly tired of Sid's weird phone obsession, but before she can call him out on it, they're taken to the police chief to get interrogated about his phone, as the bullies are in custody by being friends with a smoker who died. It's revealed that maybe Sid hasn't respected the law that much, but before Captain Hook, because yes, that's his name, can continue, he receives a call from the cell phone and lets the two go almost scot-free. Sid comes to the realization that his phone might not actually be the most innocent device, as he learns of Fritz the Chicken Man's death, which prompts him to rush away from Angie, hoping to keep her safe, and she's just as confused as everyone would be at that point. Sid frantically tries to ask why the phone is killing so many people, to which the phone responds with, "I love you." He then goes to Tiger's house to get help, but is understandably given the cold shoulder, so he walks in only to be cornered by his porn star mom. Tiger then sees a scene reminiscent of MILF Manor and socks Sid, only to run out into the night. Sid then goes home to try to break his phone by force, which obviously doesn't work as the phone bites him or something. He tries to get rid of it by throwing it into a bottomless pit, which has probably worked. The bullies and Angie's friends then meet up at Angie's house, where they try to figure out how Franklin the bully died. Also, the bottomless pit didn't work as miners came to his house to get the phone back. The best character also comes back to see Sid to help out in taking the phone down, which is great as the second act falling out didn't last too long. He then receives an ominous call from his phone, which tells him that the phone loves him and warns him that Angie is the next target, which shows a pretty funny sequence of events, as Tiger decks Sid with a cactus. What follows though is a pretty good sequence of events that actually makes us feel something that isn't hatred for everyone at Angie's house. What we feel instead is pity, as we know that whoever answers the phone call will probably die next, since the phone has made it very clear that it won't hold back anymore. This pity is immediately retracted though, as Clements think it would be funny to pull a prank on everyone by pretending to be possessed after answering the phone. Turns out it was just Angie's mom, so the tension still somewhat lingers. Margot then answers the phone and stabs herself multiple times with multiple utensils in a scene reminiscent of that one death in DDLC. The dozens of sharp objects in her could symbolize the way that she was hurt by her boyfriend, the Green Goblin, as he explains multiple times that he is in it only to get laid. Maybe the objects jabbed into her are supposed to represent the pressure put onto her by the insane teenager. This is made slightly more evident when the first thing he says after examining her body is asking if he's going to be a virgin his entire life. Clemens then starts to yell at Virgil, and as everyone would at that point, he throws Fazgoo onto her, which dries and traps her in, probably suffocating her in the process. Norman Osborn then kills Virgil, which makes him the true hero of the story, and the one who got all that sweet, sweet victory royale. Angie's dog then answers a phone call in the most "what the dog doing" moment, and it becomes a wolf thanks to the mysterious hell phone powers, which apparently can also affect animals now. David then tries to talk to the dog, which works at first, until he insults it, which leads him to getting mauled to death in the bite of 07. Tiger and Sid finally arrive at the mansion where they find Angie fighting her mother. They knock out her mother in the last moment, and Tiger asks who that bitch is. Wacky hijinks ensue.
C'est qui cette vieille pouf?
C'est ma mère!
So every one-dimensional villain is now dead, and the main characters are left to figure out a way to get rid of the hell phone. They decide on the hydraulic press, which should normally work, but on the way there, they find out that the family dog has been killed under mysterious circumstances. How unwholesome. Turns out Virgil isn't dead, which makes this the third fake-out death in the movie so far, and he looks like a slightly more messed up Edward Scissorhands. So he and Sid duke it out in the hallway. This leads to a chainsaw battle, which is reminiscent of a certain anime I just can't get the name of at this point for some reason. I think it had something to do with a man made of chainsaws. The hydraulic press crunches down the phone and forces it to repair slowly, but it's still active, so Sid gets a final idea to get rid of the phone once and for all. The phone reactivates itself and calls multiple people at once as a last resort in order to finally get Sid all to himself in what seems to be the most confusing yandere plotline ever made. The three convince everyone to not pick up their phones, but the principal, who's already been affected, forces the chemistry teacher to answer the phone, rendering her useless in the final battle against the hell phone. Both she and the principal die, and the students are left flabbergasted. Almost everyone leaves the classroom in panic, leaving the trio of protagonists to share one final moment together as a horde of possessed people approach. Once again, we can see the use of red in a much less subtle way, as almost every member of the sea of people are dressed in a bright red, linking it all back to the yandere phone. This then becomes a zombie movie, as the three high schoolers frantically try to barricade themselves in a science lab of all places. Tensions drop though, as the main couple tries to make out in their final moments, but before they can actually get it on, Sid decides to freeze the phone to a metaphorical cyberspace death. It fails though, and the horde get a hold of the phone to convey very non-subtly the message of phone bad because everyone is addicted. Tiger gets the phone, but is forced to listen to a call that tells him to kill or something, I don't really know, it's never explained. He then drops the phone into the liquid nitrogen from earlier in the movie, letting that Chekhov's gun shoot, and the phone is immediately frozen, which hopefully frees everyone from the weird mind control. Tiger once again proves that he is by far the best character in the movie by showing that he was actually wearing AirPods the entire time, protecting him from phone calls and potential mind wipes. They embrace, and Tiger even gets a kiss from Angie, which who knows might have awakened something in Sid. Cut to some time later, where the trio of protagonists are on a cruise ship off to the UK, off which they throw the nitrogen canister into the ocean, which is a form of pollution, and is the thing that would force Greta Thunberg to sail to America, as dumping a possessed Chinese phone into the ocean is just too much. How dare you? The movie then ends with the main couple making out while Tiger just walks away because redheads can't get a happy ending. So I know that this movie was very clear about its phone bad messaging, as the whole premise of the movie was just, what if too many phone calls equals bad? Sure, it's probably as baby boomer as it gets with opinions, but something about creating a few characters that you could have met in high school who try their best to help out in their house by working odd jobs and doing kooky things to keep sane, and putting them in a world full of insane one-dimensional villains is beautiful. At the end of the day, while the bullies were evil and had no redeeming qualities, the movie tries to show that evil doesn't necessarily come from others. Sid is a character who definitely has not been dealt the best hand by God, and probably does more good than bad. This movie does a great job at exploring just what one small device can do up to a person, how much one person can be corrupted by even the smallest things, and for that I believe this movie deserves credit. While most of the characters aren't fully fleshed out, I do believe that the writing, while in French, is still incredibly witty and quick-paced, which fully encapsulates the high school experience with all its cynicism. I really urge you to watch the movie if you ever have the time. You can find it on streaming websites. websites, and while subtitles lose a bit of power when it comes to actual line delivery or jokes, they don't completely ruin the experience. And I know that this movie is very French in its humor. I mean, the math teacher is called Mr. Mazot, which is masochist in French, but like, it's spelled in a really weird way that only French people would understand. But it's a great movie, and I really recommend you watch it when you have a chance. So that was Hellphone, everyone. Hope you learned a few things about a really cool French movie, and who knows, it could have even taken you down the James Huth rabbit hole. With that, I thank you for watching, like and subscribe for more life-changing content, and goodbye!